good evening. Welcome. My name's Vivian Parry, and I'm delighted to be your host for this very special event. It's the second lecture in the University of Surrey's highly regarded Adam Sweeting lecture series. And boy, have we got a belter for you tonight. It's going to be terrific because we are joined by Professor Dame Linda Partridge, and the topic that we've given her is, can we cure ageing? It's something I think that might intrigue many of us. So we are going to have her speaking, then we're going to have questions. So think of all the things you'd ever wanted to ask about ageing. But first of all, I'm going to introduce Professor Max Liu, who's President and Vice Chancellor of the University of Surrey. Max.
Thank you, Vivian. Thank you for your introduction. And distinguished guests, our honoured speaker, Professor Dame Linda Partridge, Professor Alfred Adams, and Professor Martin Sweeting. Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Welcome to the University of Surrey's Adam Sweeting Lecture. And this prestigious lecture series is set up in honour of the two trailblazers in science and technology within the university's community, Professor Alf Adams and Professor Martin Sweeting. As many of you know, Professor Adams is an eminent British physicist who invented the strand layer quantum well laser, better known as the barcode reader, that you will find at your supermarket's checkout till, and the laser in your DVD players. It is still considered to be one of the top 10 greatest UK inventions of all time. Professor Sir Martin Sweeting is renowned for his work, pioneering work of modern small satellite, a concept that has fundamentally revolutionized the economics of space industry, has made Surrey the home of small satellite design and manufacturing. Through this lecture series, their legacy lives on. As we bring in eminent speakers to share their groundbreaking findings and their discoveries in search for answers to life's most challenging questions. And we create a platform to inform, excite, and inspire the next generation of scientists, engineers, and researchers, innovators. Tonight, we are so delighted and privileged to hear from Professor Dame Linda Partridge about her pioneering work in one very important phenomenon in life that affects us all, aging. All of us are growing older. Hopefully all of us will reach a grand old age and remain in good health. But we know the reality is very different for many. As the saying goes, age doesn't come alone, and there are so many important questions about aging and how we can manage age-related disorders and diseases, and how we can remain in good health as we grow older. Professor Partridge is grappling with these difficult and challenging questions, and she's a world pioneering geneticist and founding director of the Max Planck Institute for Biology of Aging in Cologne. So a very warm welcome to Professor Partridge. So we are very honored to have you with us, and thank you for sharing your work with us. Now, it gives me great pleasure to introduce my friend, our MC this evening, the renowned broadcaster, communicator, Vivian Parry, who will formally introduce our distinguished speaker. So Vivian will be a very known voice to many as she appears regularly on TV and radio. She's been the host for BBC Radio 4. And she has presented many science programs, including Am I Normal? Just So Science, and Inside the Ethics Committee. Her television work includes being presenter of the BBC's popular science programme Tomorrow's World and reporting for Panorama. She's passionate about explaining complex science into something that is easy for people to understand, and which makes her a perfect host for this evening's lecture. Now, Vivian, over to you.
Max, thank you so much. You're too kind. So, aging, something, as Max says, that concerns all of us. And Dame Linda Partridge has been a pioneer in the study of biology of aging and age-related diseases. And as she gives her lecture tonight, you will no doubt have some questions, and you can put any questions that you have in the Ask the Speaker chat box. And I think we're already getting some questions in, Linda. So there are many, many things to be answered here. So Dame Linda's research is directed towards understanding the mechanisms by which healthy lifespan can be extended in laboratory model organisms and in humans. Her work has focused in particular on nutrient sensing pathways and diet, and her primary interest is in geroprotective drugs, so drugs that prevent you aging. She's had a million awards. She is one of Britain's most distinguished scientists, a dame of the for her services to science. She's also a fellow of the Royal Society, and she's Weldon Professor of Biometry at the Department of Genetics, Evolution and Environment at University College London. And in 2008, she became the founding director of the Max Planck Institute for Biology of Aging in Cologne, Germany. And she now divides her time between Cologne and UCL. So it's now my great pleasure to introduce Professor Dame Linda Partridge, live from Germany. Well, I think actually you're live from North London. Are you live from North London, Linda?
Yes.
Live from North London. But one thing before we start, Linda, I just wanted to check out. We're talking about extending lifespan, but if you're watching this, thinking that you're about to get the secret of living to 212, this is about healthy lifespan, not immortality. Am I right, Linda?
Very much so. What we're trying to do is to keep people healthier for longer before they die, not extend their lifespan. That's happening anyway.
Very good. So thank you so much, Linda. Let's now have your lecture.
A very warm thanks to the University of Surrey for the invitation to give this Adams Sweeting lecture. It's a great honour. So thank you very much. And also thank you, Vivian, for an extraordinarily kind introduction. So why would we want to cure ageing? Why might we even want to find drugs to cure ageing? Well, we humans have been very good at causing ourselves to live longer over the decades. It's a trend that's been going on for quite some time now. And it's illustrated here with some data that were analysed by Matthias, who was a PhD student at UCL. And he used the data from the UN World Population Prospects to look at the proportion of different age classes in the global population, starting in 1950 on the left, and then projected to 2100 on the right. And what you can see is a steady decline in the 5 to 64 age group, both 5 to 14 and 15 to 64 are projected to decline, while the proportion of individuals over 65 will increase. And this is partly caused by declining birth rates, but also the marked increase in human life expectancy. So that's a trend that's been going on since the middle of the 19th century at an astonishing rate of about 2.5 years per decade, 6 hours a day increase in human life expectancy over that period. And the prospects are that the increase will at least be maintained and might continue. So this was a paper published pre-pandemic, but what we have here up the vertical axis are countries for which there's good population data. And what's plotted here for each of them is the mean and the fuzzy estimate of what life expectancy will be in 2030 based on current age-specific survival rates. And you can see that South Korea is projected to be the world leader for both women on the left and men on the right by 2030. And for all of these countries, at the time the estimates were made, there was a projected increase in life expectancy. The pandemic may have something to say about that. I mean, rather tragically, in the UK, life expectancy for males has somewhat declined as a result of the pandemic. But long lives are projected to stay with us. And so we're seeing some really quite remarkable lifespans. These are the two of the record holders, both of them ladies. The all-time world record holder for lifespan, I think, is Jean-Louise Calment. She's a French woman who was born in South France, and she was born in 1875 and died in 1997 at the age of 122 and a half or so. Not at all clear what her secret was. She came from quite a long-lived family, and human lifespan is somewhat heritable. On the other hand, she wasn't a particularly wonderful advert for the kind of healthy lifestyle that we might hope to see associated with this achievement. She actually didn't give up smoking until she was 117. So who knows what her secret was. And the oldest living person at the moment is Kenny Tanaka, who was born in January 1903. So she's over 118 years old. She's actually the third longest life person ever. And again, not at all clear that there's anything exceptional in her family background or her lifestyle that would explain it. But this is something to be celebrated, clearly. You know, we've improved over the decades, our living circumstances, we've maintained our health for a given age better, and so we're living longer. But unfortunately, what is happening here is that healthy lifespan is not keeping up with overall lifespan. And so what we're seeing is an increased burden of frailty, ill health, loss of function at the end of life, including a high burden of disease. Again, these are data analysed by Matthias, this time from the Global Burden of Disease Study, and he's looked at two low-income countries on the left, Afghanistan and Ethiopia, middle-income India and Brazil, and high-income Japan and Switzerland. And these are the three chronic and killer diseases of our times: cardiovascular disease, dementia, and neoplasms, cancers, at the bottom. And for cardiovascular disease and neoplasms, the data are normalized to the rate at age 20. This is to take into account the fact that the medical care and diagnosis is so different in these different countries. And for dementia, which tends to start later in life, the rates are scaled to age 40. But actually, it doesn't matter how you cut it. I mean, both the women data in the beige and the male data in the emerald green show that there's a very strong age effect on the incidence of these diseases. And that's leading to an increased prevalence of something which is very problematic, which is multimorbidity. This is the presence of more than one disease in a single individual. So these are data from Scotland for men. The data for women look very similar, and they look very similar in other countries. What they say is that as you go from left to right, getting older, you get a higher and higher proportion of people in the population with the darker colours, the presence of more than one condition in a single individual. So age-related disease and multimorbidity, which is complicated because often different diseases require different treatments, and the drugs used to treat them can interact with each other, they're having a large and increasing effect on healthcare systems, economies, and also on people. So we're living much, much longer than we did in our evolutionary past. And that means that natural selection simply hasn't had a chance to hone these advanced ages that we're reaching now. It hasn't had a chance to optimize the function to maintain health and maintain survival. So the major burden of loss of function and ill health is now falling on the older section of the population. Now, I think there's a lot of ageism in our society, and unhealthy aging is somehow regarded often as natural or normal. You know, what do you expect at your age? But I think there's an ethical imperative to try to find ways of keeping people healthier for longer before they die, to try to compress this period of loss of function and ill health at the end of life. We've always, throughout medical history, regarded ill health as something that we should try to do something about and prevent. It just so happens that now it's mainly old people who are suffering from it. And the kind of research that I and many other people do is aiming towards that. It's not trying to make people live longer, that's happening already. It's to try to keep them healthier for longer at the end of their lives. That may sound far-fetched, but there are some quite strong hints from nature and from other biological evidence that we should be able to do this. So for a start, aging isn't inevitable. There are some creatures that don't seem to age at all. And these are two of them, a sea anemone on the left and the little freshwater hydra on the right. And as far as anyone can see, as they go through their lives, they don't become any more likely to die or any less able to reproduce. And one of the striking things about both of them is they have astonishing powers of regeneration. They have huge numbers of stem cells present in their tissues, and they completely renew all of their body over quite a modest period of time. And that may well be a hint as to how they manage to avoid aging. But there are other creatures that don't have these astonishing regenerative powers, but that are nonetheless capable of living for a very long time. And these are some of them. So as far as I know, the bowhead whale is the mammalian record holder, and it's capable of living for 200 years, aged originally by the harpoon heads that were found embedded in the animals sometimes. The Greenland shark was only discovered a few years ago to be astonishingly long-lived, so it can live almost 400 years. And in fact, it doesn't start reproducing until it's 150. So an astonishingly slow kind of lifestyle. And large size is not necessary for long lives. Small things can live a very long time too. In fact, there's no evidence that body size has any direct effect on how long a creature lives. So this little ocean quahog down on the left, which lives on the floor of the North Atlantic, can live for 507 years. And the naked mole rat in the middle is just a fascinating animal. They're very highly social. They live in colonies, in burrows, with a single breeding pair, and they're intermediate in body size between a mouse and a rat, and they're capable of living 30 years, which is a really long time for a rodent. And then on the bottom right, you can see the tiny Brandt's bat just sitting on someone's finger. It only weighs 8 grams, but it can live 40 years in nature. So there are these quite dramatic lifespans associated with these different lifestyles. And the differences between these creatures are genetic. So somehow there are genes that affect the rate of aging. And so there's been a lot of interest in whether we could find those genes and somehow exploit them to help humans during their own aging process. Very tragically, there are some genes that seem to affect the rate of aging in humans, but what they do is to accelerate it. They're the premature aging syndromes. And I've just shown two of them here. So Hutchinson-Gilford progeria on the left is very extreme. Mercifully, it's extremely rare. But these children are born seemingly normal, but then quite rapidly they start to lose subcutaneous fat, their hair becomes stiff, and they develop heart disease, atherosclerosis, and they typically die at around the age of 18 months to 2 years. Werner syndrome on the right is much less severe. It has an onset in the late teens. And typically these individuals live into their 40s or 50s, but die prematurely of either cancer or heart disease. And interestingly, tragic though they are, I think both of these conditions tell us something very interesting, which is that the role of the genetic material in the aging process, because both of them involve genes that are involved in handling of the genetic material. So Hutchinson-Gilford progeria is caused by a mutation in a gene that actually codes a protein that sits in the nuclear envelope of the cell. So this affects the structure of the nucleus where the genetic material is found and the way in which it's packed. So it's probably being abnormally expressed. Werner syndrome involves a protein that replicates the DNA, that makes new copies when cells divide. And that means, again, that mistakes are made in the DNA itself. So it's a strong hint, I think, that the genetic material and damage to it might be important in the aging process. But clearly what we're interested in here really is mutations that slow down the rate of aging, not that accelerate it. And here, I think the main discoveries so far have come from work with animals, and particularly these animals. These are the laboratory model organisms, the workhorses of modern biology. So we've got budding yeast on the top left, the nematode worm, Caenorhabditis elegans, top right, my favourite animal, the fruit fly, Drosophila, bottom left, and the laboratory mouse. And a huge recent breakthrough with these animals has been the discovery of many of these genes that are important in ageing. And the whole process, I think, was kicked off by a very important experiment done by somebody called Cynthia Kenyon. And she was working with this worm at the top right. And what she decided to do was to feed her worms a chemical mutagen, something that causes changes in the genetic material. And she simply asked, if I do that, can I isolate strains of worms that are long-lived? And she found that she could. In fact, they were dramatically long-lived. So this whole trail kicked off in 1993 with what I think was this really key paper. And you can see the survival curves of these mutant worms at the bottom. So it's a proportion alive, the controls are in the open boxes. And you can see the vast increase in both the middle and the maximum lifespan of the mutants. And importantly, this was an extension of healthy lifespan. It wasn't just the moribund period at the end of the life of these worms. They were wriggling around and healthy when the control worms, the wild-type worms, were long since dead. It took a long time to figure out what this mutation was. It's called DAF2, but it turned out to be in a gene that encoded the worm insulin-like growth factor receptor, the presence of which in worms had not previously been suspected. And this is a system, as you know, that in mammals, insulin-like growth factor is important in growth and in wound healing, whereas insulin is very important metabolically. It controls blood sugar and energy transactions in the body. And this is part of a good time nutrient sensing network. It figures out whether the cells in the animal are well-fed and free of stress. And if so, the creature goes ahead, it can grow, it can reproduce, it can do immune responses, it can crank up its metabolism to do all these things. Whereas if nutrients are short or there's some form of stress, then it tamps everything down. And very interesting, these mutations didn't just increase lifespan and health during aging in these worms. They could actually combat worm models of human age-related disease. So this actually is a worm model of Alzheimer's disease. What's happened is that a toxic protein that's normally present in the brains of Alzheimer's patients, beta amyloid, is expressed in the muscles of these worms genetically using an artificial gene expression system. And you can see what happens here. The poor worm is paralyzed at its back end and is just rather feebly wriggling at the front end. So the Alzheimer's model has quite a dramatic effect on the worm. But this is what happens if she combines the mutation with one of these DAF2 mutations. So you've got the poor paralyzed worm on the right, normality restored on the left. These worms are perfectly healthy. So I think this is quite a dramatic demonstration that this is a strongly pro-health mutation in these worms. And it can also protect in worm models of cancer. People have made other models of human cancers in these creatures. And again, the DAF2 mutation is protective against pathology. So what we're interested in, of course, is healthy humans, not healthy worms. And one of the great things about this insulin IGF network, and it's a much bigger network, it includes many components, is that it's present throughout the animal kingdom pretty well, including in us. And it turned out that the effects of these mutations was evolutionarily conserved. So this was quite a long trail that went on, over some years. But we've got the DAF2 mutation on the left here again. A very similar mutation in flies, a mutation called Chico, made them long-lived. It also made them small, as it happens, but that is not necessary for the increase in lifespan. We can separate these two. It's just two things that the pathway does at different periods in the life of the animal. And this is a Chico worm. It's lost the same gene as here. And again, you can see this nice increase in lifespan in these mutant mice. And of course, in these mice, we were particularly interested in the issue of health during aging. And they showed what you might expect for a mutation that is actually slowing down the aging process, which is quite a broad spectrum improvement in health as aging went along. So for instance, they show better glucose homeostasis, so that whole metabolic axis is working better, better immune profile, more naive T cells. They maintain their motor function better into old age. They have less osteoporosis and cataract. You can see cataract here on the eye of this control worm. So these are littermate sisters. At the age of about 850 days, which is an old age for mice. And you can see this ulcerative dermatitis on the head and nape of the control. The mutants are completely protected. So we've got these very different systems in the body of these mice, all being protected by this one mutation. And as in the worm, these mutations can protect against the effects of a mutation involved in Alzheimer's disease. So again, people have made mouse models of Alzheimer's disease by expressing these toxic proteins. And this is just an example of the kind of testing that you can do in mice to look at how they're functioning in the presence of these mutations. So this is a learning test. This is called a Morris water maze. And what happens here is that the mouse is introduced to the cloudy water in this tank. And mice don't much like swimming. They would much rather stand on solid ground. And initially, there's a visible platform that they can swim to. And you can just see the shadow in the water here at the back where the platform is. And initially, the mice are trained with the platform visible. It's above the cloudy liquid and with these landmarks on the wall. But then after a certain number of learning trials, the platform is lowered so the mouse could no longer see it. And it has to remember the relationship, the spatial relationship of the platform to these landmarks in order to find it. And if you do that with an Alzheimer's mouse, it can swim perfectly well. There's nothing wrong with it swimming. It's just as fast as a wild type mouse, but it searches more or less randomly. Its path goes all over the tank. Whereas if we add the insulin pathway mutant from the mouse, you can see that it locates it's searching in the area of the platform and actually manages to find it much more quickly. And of course, that's just an anecdote. I've just shown you a couple of films, but if we quantify these things properly and you know, do a statistical analysis, the mutant protects these Alzheimer's disease mice from impairment of memory, from reduced motor coordination, which sets in later in the disease than you saw in the previous mice, from brain inflammation, which you can see here, this astrocytosis, you can see these darkly strained astrocytes in the Alzheimer's mouse on the left at the bottom, whereas on the right, that they're far less numerous in the old mouse. And also they lose far fewer of their nerve cells, their neurons. So this mutation really is protective, and there've been several other similar studies. So of course, what we would like to know is whether this pathway or this network rather is important in human aging. And the main way that that has been investigated is by finding long-lived individuals or long-lived families and asking whether they tend to carry mutations in the same genes, the equivalent genes that have been shown to be important in aging in the animal world, in the laboratory, the kinds of mutations I've just been talking about. And there are a lot of studies coming out on this now. We can either look at whether individuals actually have an interesting looking mutant in the genes, or we can look at the gene product, usually a protein, and see if its expression level in these individuals has been altered compared to the general population that are not as long lived. These are just some of the publications that have come out on this. FOXO3A is very interesting. It's something called a transcription factor. It's a protein that goes into the nucleus of cells and alters gene expression. And this particular one, FOXO, in both the worm and the fly, is required for these mutations in the insulin signaling pathway to extend lifespan. And a number of studies in humans have now shown that genetic variants in this gene are associated with long lives. And there are other expression studies and association with the TOR part of the network, which particularly senses the amino acids in proteins. And this is an important meta-analysis of all the studies that picked up which genes were crucial. So, you know, straws in the wind at this stage, but very interesting straws in the wind, and the indications are positive. And this nutrient sensing network that I've been talking about, which has involved some of my own work, is just part of a much bigger picture now, because over the years, we've come to understand much better exactly what does go wrong during aging. They've become known as the hallmarks of aging, in a somewhat classic paper now that came out in 2013. And they're illustrated here in this wheel. So I think there's general agreement that the process probably kicks off with things going wrong with the genetic material, as indicated by the premature aging syndrome. So we have some form of genetic instability, mutations or damage to the DNA. We get attrition of the ends of the chromosomes in which the genes are carried. It's called telomere attrition, and that can eventually start eating into genes. Epigenetic alterations, so these are changes to the molecules stuck to the genetic material and that alter its expression. So the whole regulation of gene expression goes wrong during aging. Things then start to go wrong in the protein world in cells that's called loss of proteostasis. So the system by which proteins are made and the systems that quality control them and that degrade them if they need degrading themselves gradually go down as aging proceeds. I've already said quite a lot about deregulated nutrient sensing. It looks as though these networks are set at levels that work fine in youth, but drive too strongly at old age. So if we tamp them down, we see an improvement in health. The mitochondria are the energy powerhouses of the cells, and they can decline both in number and in function during aging. And the cellular senescence is proving to be very important. These senescent cells are normally produced either during development or during wound healing. And what they do is to remodel tissues. So after a wound, you need to gradually repair the damage. And that's what these senescent cells do. They come along and remodel. And then when the process of development and tissue formation or wound healing is over, cells from the immune system come along and remove the senescent cells. But for some reason, that goes wrong during aging and the senescent cells hang around. And they're extremely biologically active. They produce a lot of cytokines that would normally be involved in wound healing, but are now actually damaging the surrounding tissue. And they also seem to give rise to the systemic inflammatory process, which is very characteristic of aging in animals and humans. You get problems with stem cells. So they can sometimes divide when they shouldn't and misdifferentiate or fail to divide when they should. For instance, in healing a wounded muscle, they may just simply not respond to the signals that would normally induce them to repair the muscle. And finally, there's altered communication between cells, often at a distance or within tissues. So all of these processes are going wrong. Of course, they're not independent of each other. They interact. So for instance, DNA damage is a common cause of cellular senescence. And that we've got this nexus of things that are happening during aging, including the nutrient sensing. So I think a central idea now in this kind of research has become perhaps we can interfere directly in these underlying mechanisms of aging, and by doing so, prevent or even abolish multiple age-related conditions simultaneously. So rather than waiting for an age-related disease to arise and then treating it, we're focusing on prevention, and we're focusing on preventing more than one disease simultaneously, because these underlying aging processes contribute to the etiology of multiple diseases. Each one of them is present in the development of more than one age-related disease. So that gives rise to this kind of picture where we have our wheel of things that go wrong during aging. We have then the phenotypes that result from these things going wrong. So this is very much orientated to humans, loss of bone, gain of abdominal fat, altered hormone levels, mechanical and structural changes, and then eventually multimorbidity and frailty. So subclinical things to start with, just annoying things, but not diseases, but eventually things going seriously wrong. And then on the left, we have our potential interventions. And at the moment, diet and exercise are really still the two most powerful in humans to improve health at all ages, not just during aging. And there's a lot of evidence about these and a lot of work on how they achieve their effects. But the sad fact is that even people who lead a completely impeccable lifestyle are nonetheless prone to the ills of aging. It's not going to stop the problems. And so we're using genetics a lot, as I've shown you, to understand and identify the kinds of processes that happen during aging. But now we're interested in the drugs and metabolites that might prevent some of these things that go wrong by tackling these underlying aging processes. Now, some of you may be thinking a drug to combat aging, ugh, we wouldn't want to do that. Well, I think I would counter that by saying, well, in a sense, we already are. There are plenty of people, innumerable people around the world, who are taking drugs entirely preventatively for cardiovascular disease. So statins are very widely used to prevent atherosclerosis. They're used, you know, both in high-risk individuals who perhaps already had some form of cardiac incident or who come from high-risk families or who are showing signs of developing atherosclerosis. But they're also taken by plenty of members of the general public, and they're extremely effective at preventing cardiovascular disease. In fact, many cardiologists argue that after a certain age, everybody should be put on statins because they're so protective. And similarly, blood pressure lowering medication is in very wide use, but blood pressure, high blood pressure itself, is not a disease. It's a risk factor for disease. So why not use drugs to try to prevent the multiple ills of aging? It's just part of a bigger picture. And I think the greatest success so far has actually been with drugs against the nutrient sensing network. And I think also we're looking at repurposing of existing drugs mainly, rather than developing new ones, because there are really quite major challenges to developing a new anti-aging drug. So if we wanted to do that to prevent the age-related condition, first of all, we might be looking at long-term drug treatment, so it had better be extremely safe. The pharmaceutical industry would be facing great challenges for doing the clinical trials, because the outcome is aging, so multiple things that can go wrong. It's not targeted against a specific disease. So we'd be talking about long clinical trials on a lot of people, which would be extremely expensive. And the regulators would also be very interested in this. So I think a huge advantage of existing drugs is that they've been through many of the steps, the regulatory steps already, the safety steps and so on. And luckily, many of them do act against processes that we now know are important in aging. And I think the ones furthest down the road in this respect are ones that I talked about earlier. So this is a cartoon of this nutrient sensing network in flies. And what we have here is a cell surface with a receptor and the ligands, the equivalent of the mammalian insulins and IGFs that bind to this receptor. There's then a signaling cascade, quite a complicated one. And this RAS pathway here is actually very important in cancer, but also it turns out important in aging. And on the right here, we have the more classical insulin signaling pathway, and they go down to this bunch of transcription factors that alter gene expression. I've already mentioned FOXO. So we have ligands that talk to a receptor that then talk to other proteins in cells that activate or deactivate these transcription factors and interact with this intracellular, much more ancient Tor bit of the network that senses amino acids. And we've actually been taking an interest in three drugs. One of them is trametinib, which inhibits this RAS branch. Another one, trametinib is normally used to treat malignant melanoma. It's a GSK drug. Rapamycin inhibits this intracellular Tor bit of the network. And lithium inhibits GSK3, which is known as Shaggy in the fly. So rapamycin in humans is licensed to prevent tissue rejection after transplant, particularly of kidneys. It's also used as an anti-cancer chemotherapeutic and to prevent restenosis after cardiac surgery to keep the tubes clear. Lithium is used against bipolar disorder, and all three are licensed for human use. It turns out they work just fine against the equivalent target in the fly, and they each individually extend fly lifespan. So this was work by Jorge, who was a student in the lab at UCL and is now at Harvard as a postdoc. And you can see that each of these drugs individually, lithium chloride, rapamycin and trametinib, so the green, yellow and purple here, individually extends lifespan. If we put them together in pairs, we get an even bigger extension of lifespan. And in red, with all three together, we get what by fly standards is an absolutely massive extension. So we can pick up the functions of these drugs, of these gene products with drugs. We can do the equivalent of a genetic experiment, but this time by targeting the product of the gene. And in the fly, at least, we can have these dramatic effects on lifespan. And again, these flies maintain their health during aging. So what about the possibility of human use? The one of these that I think is the furthest down this road is rapamycin, this one that inhibits the TOR network. And an important landmark in the field was the demonstration that it can extend lifespan in mice. It was one of the first drugs that was really clearly shown to do so. It was discovered in the soil on Easter Island. An expedition looking for compounds in the soil made by soil microbes that could inhibit mammalian cell division. So it's a naturally occurring compound actually used in fights between the microorganisms themselves. And you can see here the dose-dependent response of male and female lifespan to the drug. So we don't yet know what the maximum lifespan extension is. Even at the highest dose, we're still seeing an increase in the effect in these mice. And it's turned out to be a very effective drug against a number of diseases in animals. So again, it can protect in a mouse model of Alzheimer's disease. And there's been a lot of discussion of broadening its therapeutic scope to other diseases, which is interesting if it's a geroprotector, a drug that protects against the effects of aging. And this was an important piece of work, the bottom paper here, because what it showed was that it can potentiate the response to immunization against influenza in mice. So just like aging humans, aging mice respond badly to immunization against influenza. But if you pre-treat them with rapamycin, let them clear the drug and then do the immunization, you get a much stronger immune response to the immunization and they're better protected against a challenge with the flu virus. And Novartis initially, and now Restore Bio, led by Joan Manick, who I think is a real pioneer in this area, has started to look at this in humans. So Joan did a very similar treatment in humans. She simply got a group of elderly people who were about to be immunized against flu. And in half of them, she pre-treated with rapamycin. The other was a control group, just treated with the carrier. And just like in the mice, what she found was that the immune response to the immunization was stronger in the pre-treated group. She actually didn't use rapamycin, she used equivalent proprietary drugs from the company, but the same thing, they inhibit the TORC1 complex. And she found that they got fewer validated respiratory infections, viral infections, respiratory infections in the ensuing winter. So this is very much a step in the direction of using rapamycin now as a geroprotector rather than on its original uses. And another very important development in the States is that now the FDA actually recognizes aging as a valid outcome for this type of clinical trial. So this is a study of metformin. Metformin is very widely used for the treatment of type 2 diabetes. It is the first line of defense against the disease. And there's an application in now to do a very large study looking at whether its effects are broader than just against type 2 diabetes and whether it can improve health during aging in humans. This trial isn't running yet, but I think it's getting close to doing so. I think it's starting to achieve its funding. So that's very much the nutrient sensing network, but there are other very interesting emerging opportunities in the area. So I think one of them is to target cellular senescence. So it's very important in the osteoarthritis process, the etiology of the disease. So if you look at an arthritic joint, there's accumulation of senescent cells in that joint. And in this study, what they did was to look at osteoarthritis in mice and basically find that if they introduced a drug that selectively killed the senescent cells but left the ordinary cells unharmed, then they could produce a quite marked improvement on the right if they looked for signs of osteoporosis in the joints. These drugs that kill senescent cells, they do tend to be rather toxic at the moment. And therefore, it's going to be ideal to use them in parts of the body that are compartmentalized rather than using them systemically. Joints are a very good example of that because they're in a capsule. The eye is another very strong candidate for this kind of treatment because of the importance of senescent cells in age-related degeneration of the retina. So I think there are real opportunities here and a number of studies looking at this. So intervertebral disc degeneration, these are all in animals rather than humans. Health and lifespan in mice and glial cells, these are the cells that associate with nerve cells in brains. The top right is actually a very preliminary study with humans. So idiopathic pulmonary fibrosis is a lethal condition in humans and there's no line of treatment for it. So this was actually a safety study and it went well. It looks as though for this condition, it may also be a possible way in. The other very interesting area at the moment, I think, is this whole area of systemic inflammation and failure of communication between cells, deteriorating systemic environment. This originally came to light through these rather Frankenstein kind of experiments where the blood systems of two mice were actually conjoined with each other. You can do that in mice because they're completely inbred and genetically identical. And you could either do a control, hitch up a young mouse to a young mouse or an old mouse to an old mouse or young to old. And what they found was that being attached to the blood supply of a young mice was extremely good for the health of the older mouse. And in particular, it restored stem cell function in a variety of different tissues. We do this quite differently now, generally using plasma rather than actually joining two mice together. But here are some of the studies that have been coming out recently, both finding molecules that are present in the blood of the old mouse that we would probably want to remove because they seem to be causing problems, and molecules in the blood of the young mouse that seem to be beneficial. And again, safety trials, bottom right here, are starting up in humans. So this, I think, is another very promising area of intervention. So I hope I've convinced you that there are some interesting and promising lines coming up from this research into aging, and that perhaps the prospects for improving human health are not so far away. So to summarize, we're dealing with a malleable process. Aging can be altered, we can target it in different ways. Nutrient sensing networks play an evolutionarily conserved role, but so do many other processes. Slowing aging by mutations or drugs can protect against diverse aging-related diseases. And I hope what we're looking forward to is a broad spectrum preventative medicine for the diseases of aging. And I'd like to thank you very much for coming to my lecture, and I'm very happy to discuss some of this with you.
Linda, that was absolutely wonderful, really wonderful. And there are so many questions that it raises. I mean, one of the things that struck me immediately was how many of the things that we think of as immutable laws are actually being overturned by this research. The idea that, you know, for instance, there are no stem cells left, or that, you know, once you've reached a certain point, you know, you can't do anything to retrieve the body. I mean, all those kinds of things have to be reconsidered. And I think one of the things is that, this way of actually thinking of diseases, not just as single diseases, and so many of the diseases that we have are considered in silos. It's diabetes, or it's cardiovascular disease, or it's something else. But actually what you're suggesting is that you should be thinking of a body-wide treatment, which really completely overturns a lot of accepted medical wisdom.
Yes, absolutely so. I mean, it's clear from studies of how diseases develop that DNA damage, for instance, goes across a huge number of different diseases, and so does cellular senescence. So yes, what eventually turns up as a diagnosed clinical condition in an individual is probably an indication that those processes are going on quite broadly and are likely to pop up as other diseases later on. You're absolutely right. So I do think this idea that we should try and intervene early in that process to prevent is really key to this.
And I was wondering, do you see accelerated aging in those with diabetes, or in those people whose nutrient sensing has clearly gone severely awry, who develop this muscle wasting that you see in old age? Do you see increased aging or accelerated aging in those particular groups?
Well, the effects are usually rather specific. So rather than seeing the kind of body-wide effects that you see during normal aging, where different parts of the body are affected and the whole thing goes down gently in a more or less synchronous fashion, that there are specific lesions there. And certainly in both of those, they're actually quite reversible by lifestyle interventions. So a lot of type 2 diabetes can be rescued by exercise and diet. And actually, there's a lot of interest now in the possibility of using diet to prevent frailty and muscle wasting. It may well be, although real clear experimental evidence is lacking at the moment, but it may be that as people get older, they should eat slightly more protein to prevent this muscle wasting, the sarcopenia, that's very common at older ages. So I think there are a number of lifestyle interventions that could be valuable there.
Max, Lou, you had a question here. Would you like to ask it?
I just wondered, this is a really fascinating talk. I really enjoyed it, Linda. Thank you. We often hear that, there are many factors that affect the decline of regenerative ability in ourselves in the intracellular sort of sense. I wonder whether, apart from therapeutics, whether exercise, restriction on calories and fasting do work, or in combination as a holistic work in slowing down the decline, or even reverse the decline, particularly for neurons.
Yes, I think there's a lot of evidence that's true. I mean, getting the experimental evidence in humans is quite tricky. I mean, in animals, it's very clear that dietary restriction is actually still by far the most powerful intervention that we have to improve health during aging. So dietarily restricted rodents, for instance, or even rhesus monkeys, show an astonishingly broad improvement in health as they get old. There are only two things that they're bad at compared with animals that are just eating ad lib. One is clearing viral infections, and the other is wound healing. If they face either of those challenges, they need to refeed. But aside from those, there's an incredibly broad benefit in health. The problem with humans, of course, is that we find it terribly difficult to comply with dietary restriction regimes. There have been attempted clinical trials on dietary restriction, and the main problem has been compliance. There are often a lot of volunteers to start with, but the number who actually go through the program is very, very much reduced. So that means that I think there's a lot of interest in finding dietary interventions that achieve some of the benefits of dietary restriction without dietary restriction. And intermittent fasting, I think, is one that people are very interested in. Time-restricted feeding, just confining eating to particular periods during the wake cycle. I mean, clearly in mice, that's extremely beneficial for metabolic health. And again, getting the information for humans is so easy. But diet composition also. I mean, dietary restriction is not calorie restriction. That's why I'm calling it dietary restriction, it's clear that what nutrients you take out of the diet is really important. It's not just bulk calories. And there's a lot of indication that protein can be particularly important. Getting the right proportion of protein in the diet is really crucial. So I think there are more subtle dietary interventions that could recapture some of the benefits of dietary restriction. And also, of course, we're interested in the genes that mediate the effect, you know, what genes change expression in response to dietary restriction, and can we capture some of that with drugs?
You do wonder whether there's an opportunity for somebody to formulate a special sort of biscuit, because older people seem to live on biscuits, that actually has the right combination of proteins in it, so that they're, because we have all these protein bars for these muscly types of, you know, 25, but actually perhaps the real people who need to have those kind of things are older people. Martin Sweeting, you have a question. Would you like to ask it?
Yes, I mean, absolutely wonderful talk, Linda, really fascinating, and something that, of course, now I should start to pay attention to, I think. But I had really two questions. One is a general one, going back to the beginning of your talk, when you were looking at the experiences across different countries. I wonder whether there was any sort of general conclusions that you could extract from the Asian lifestyle, where we see, you know, longevity in Korea, in Japan, in some parts of China, and so on, and whether there's any general conclusions that you could could draw from that, and also, of course, their holistic approach to medicine has been perhaps a central part of their medical approach for many thousands of years. And then, just as an addition to that, in a totally different environment, I wonder whether there's been any conclusions drawn from the behavior of astronaut metabolisms in the space station, and whether that's given you any hints as to how things are going when they are exposed to weightlessness and a slightly different radiation environment.
Gosh. Well, the first one, I think it is going to be holistic. I think the East Asian story, it's not just one thing, but it was clear for many years until they adopted the Western diet that the Okinawans, so this southern Japanese island, Okinawa, they were extraordinarily long-lived, even by Japanese standards. And they ate a very modest diet, so very low intake, but also predominantly vegetarian, fish, all of the things that we would associate with a healthy eating style, somewhat Mediterranean diet almost, although of course without dairy in Japan. And it was very clear that as soon as they changed that diet, that they got a great deal larger and their lifespans started to come down. So I think diet's certainly an important part of it. But, you know, there are these blue zones in the world that within countries, you know, there's a patch in Sardinia, Loma, there's a place in California, there are the Japanese. And there's a concatenation of low stress lifestyle, plenty of exercise, healthy diet, you know, all of the things that really we know about that clearly make for a healthy aging style.
So the questions are coming in thick and fast here now. So somebody's asking, in the Alzheimer's protective mouse, are there changes in the anatomical or physiological findings in the brain? And I might add that in Nature Aging this week, in case you read Nature Aging, there's a very interesting paper about another drug called bumetamide, which is used, I think, to treat epilepsy, being an anti-aging drug that could be used in to prevent Alzheimer's. Linda, what yes, about changes?
That's a wonderful new paper in Nature Aging. I mean, it really is remarkable now, the rate at which drugs that are often prescribed for an extremely restricted condition, you know, something extremely specific, are actually turning out to have these much broader effects. But in answer to the question about the brain, one of the very obvious features of Alzheimer's disease in the brain is that you start to see an inflammatory response. So you see this astrocytosis, which I showed in the mouse. And it's very clear that that's reduced in these animals. The exact molecular mechanisms are not clear, but brain inflammation clearly plays a major role. And you can see that just, you know, if you do a histological section of the brain, it's clear that that aspect of the disease is being rescued.
It's fascinating because, again, it points to perhaps this kind of work may overturn some of those common thoughts that may, that, you know, Alzheimer's, for instance, is always about amyloid plaques. Maybe it's not. Maybe it's something else. Maybe we're on a kind of new pathway to thinking about Alzheimer's.
Yes, and I think quite often the amyloid plaques actually may well be a cellular defence mechanism. I mean, they're an indication that there's a disease there, but they actually reflect the cell's attempts to try and ameliorate the effects of the disease.
Another interesting question here, the hallmarks of ageing, fascinating question. So who asked this? It's a great question. Hallmarks of ageing is quite similar to the hallmarks of cancer. Is it possible to use anti-cancer treatment in the wider population to treat ageing?
That's not happening at the moment, but I think it's a really interesting prospect. So it's very clear that one of those signaling pathways in the nutrient sensing network, the RAS pathway, mutations in bits of that pathway are present in about 30% of human cancers, but it's also clear that in the animal models, it plays a very key role in aging. If you tamp down its effects, you can produce this healthy aging phenotype. So I would not be in the least surprised if over the next decade, low doses, not clinical doses, but low doses of anti-cancer drugs come in as preventative. Because so far, all the drugs that have turned up as geroprotectors exert that effect at much lower doses than are usually used clinically, where you see the side effects. So I would be really fascinated to see if low-dose cancer drugs start being used in that way.
Another interesting question. So telomere shorting, you remember that telomeres are the kind of the bootlace, like your bootlaces, they're the little caps on the end of the chromosomes that prevent the kind of unraveling completely. So telomere shortening occurring with aging won the Nobel Prize. How key is telomere shortening as seen in today's aging science landscape? Not aging science, as in the science of aging landscape.
It's very clear that telomeres do erode with age. And if you look in real tissues, in real people, you can see that the chromosomes have shortened to the point where there's actual damage to the genetic material as opposed to just the end packaging of the chromosomes. And it's associated with high rates of cell division. So typically it's measured in actually in the white blood cells simply because they're so accessible. That may partly reflect history of response to infections and other forms of stress that the immune system responds to, but it clearly is an important part of the aging process in other tissues too. So yes, I think it plays a key role.
Someone's asking, what's an older person? I think it always means older than you, but what's the official definition of an older person, Linda? Well, obviously we are in our prime, you and I, but
of course, Vivian, naturally. I think you could say it's somebody who's reached pension age. Clearly, that's the way that the government views ageing. So we'd be talking mid to late 60s in the UK at the moment. In terms of you know, people doing very heavy kind of work, it's clear that they would probably rather pack in a bit sooner than that. But I guess the watershed in most people's minds is somewhere around 60.
And is there a change in how we think of aging? I mean, I suspect we can all think of our parents at the age we might be now and think they were much older in the way that they behaved or dressed or the things that they did. And perhaps that was more about the lifespan that they had after the age of retirement, because they didn't live that so very long after retirement. They generally died within, say, 15 or 20 years, but that's not the case now.
No, and there's a huge doublethink going on here, I think. So I think Bismarck in Germany was the first person to introduce pensions. And when he introduced them and the age at which they were first handed out, actually most people didn't get to the age to receive a pension. It was really for people who, by the standards of the time, lived for an exceptionally long time. But of course, as we've seen this huge increase in life expectancy, the gap between the retirement age and death has grown and grown and grown. So, I mean, the way that governments are looking at this, I think certainly throughout Europe, is, well, people are going to have to work for longer. But on the other hand, you look from the employment side, and then you start to see a lot of ageism and a lot of discrimination against older workers. So I think we really need to get our heads together about this. If we want older people to continue to be economically productive in our societies, then we have to start dropping these ageist attitudes to what they can be expected to do. So I think this is a social change that needs to happen over the coming years and needs to happen quite fast.
So in general, Linda, we've never been very good about prevention. So we often talk a good game on prevention, but we don't walk the walk. So all the things that that could actually be preventive in terms of disease, you know, exercise, diet, stopping smoking, a lot of those don't get that much attention or funding in public health terms. Do you think this is the kind of thing that actually should get a lot more support and thought from government?
Yes, very much so. And, you know, I think there are a number of reasons for the situation that you described, with which I absolutely agree. I think it's really important. I think part of it is that, you know, some really very simple things could be done. You know, not aversive exercise classes for the elderly, but, you know, dance classes. I mean, the Chinese are very good at this. You know, opportunities to get together socially and exercise. And at that point, people can, you know, talk about their health to an expert or talk about their diet to an expert. These things would be relatively uncostly, but they would probably need to be paid for by local authorities who would be benefiting the National Health Service financially. So that's not going to happen, because the people who are spending the money are not going to see the benefit of having spent that money. So I think that's one structural issue. But I think also we have to look at the medical profession. I mean, generally, I think public health is less fashionable speciality than some of the others. Dealing constantly with older people is perhaps not what most young medical students think that they're going to be doing when they embark on medicine, although, of course, that is what the vast majority of them are going to be doing. And I think that needs a bit of sorting out too. I think there are a number of things that would need addressing to get some sensible policies going on this. And I think it's really important that those policies do get going.
On the other hand, in this particular instance, a lot of the preventive public health strategies involve lifestyle change. And we know that lifestyle change is one of the most difficult things to try and achieve. But what you're suggesting is that you might be able to use some kind of pharmaceutical in order to delay or improve a healthy lifespan. So that seems less of a problem to policymakers than perhaps lifestyle change, which has always been understood to be difficult.
Yes, but it is difficult, but I think that we have to do it, because I think the idea that you can turn a couch potato into a healthy individual by giving them a pill is probably quite unrealistic. I mean, it has to go hand in hand with other things. I mean, it's quite clear, though, that people who lead a completely, you know, blameless lifestyle, who do everything right nonetheless, can really suffer some of the ills of old age. So I think that's the point at which we should be thinking about pharmacological intervention, rather than unrealistically assuming that it will rescue a thoroughly unhealthy lifestyle. I think the other thing is that some of these things need to start really quite young, you know, in young middle age. And young and middle-aged people generally, I think, are very healthily protected psychologically against the acceptance that one day they're going to be old and they're going to have to do something about it. There's widespread and, I think, psychologically quite healthy denial about the fact that aging is going to happen. And I think that's another thing that sometimes makes it difficult to persuade younger people to take it seriously and do something about it at the time when actually they need to.
And attempts to have a kind of poly pill in which, for instance, you had statins and you had quite a number of other low dose aspirin, that kind of thing. You know, there are many enthusiasts for that approach, but there's resistance to mass medication, and people aren't even that really good about taking statins. I mean, you know, it's clear that statins have a very marked effect in reducing blood levels of cholesterol, but still people are not very good at taking them.
Yes, I think that's right. And I think they're really talking to people. And again, this is, you know, just talking to people as a public health intervention and just showing some of the remarkable improvements you can get in atherosclerosis if people do take statins. I think it's partly really, you know, convincing people that this is for them. They're not going to get side effects. These are very safe drugs, and they are going to protect their circulatory system. So I think it is a question of taking the time to talk to people. And most people, once they actually look at the statistics and see what these drugs could do for them, I think pretty open-minded about it. The polypill idea, I think, is a very interesting one. And again, may come in due course. There was a clinical trial in India, a big one, trying to prevent cardiovascular disease simply as a widespread public health measure from age 50. And it was quite successful, although I think it wouldn't include aspirin these days. The indications are that unless there's been a prior, as far as I know, as long as if there hasn't been a prior cardiovascular incident, actually the danger from bleeds from aspirin outweighs the benefits.
Martin Sweeting, you've got a thought about this.
Yes, I was just thinking that actually your comment about social behaviour, we managed to shift the whole social view of smoking over the course of about 20 years to something which was, you know, probably unheard of if you go back into the 70s and look at the social lifestyles and smoking then to where we have now. Should we not now be having the same pressure on diet and try to achieve similar effect?
I absolutely agree. And I mean, the smoking thing was achieved in a lot of different ways. It wasn't just nasty scare stories and pictures of blackened lungs, which don't always do the trick. It was things like restricting advertising, particularly in the context of sport, making the product more expensive, removing the labelling so that the packaging was not attractive. It was all sorts of different approaches, but, you know, really quite a push, and it was extraordinarily successful. And of course, the increasing, as fewer and fewer people smoked, social pressure as well.
I think that's a combination of legislation, isn't it? Because when you think that actually the paper by Richard Doll was 50 years before there was really widespread acceptance that smoking was bad, and it took a lot with legislation and all sorts. Perhaps we're going to be in that same position with food. It would be good to think so. So there's another question here. What do you think the implications of COVID will be on your line of research?
Very interesting. So I think two things. One is that, you know, depending how the pandemic continues to play out, and I mean, this really is very tragic and depressing, but, you know, undoubtedly the increase in life expectancy and healthy lifespan is going to be checked to some extent, particularly in countries that have had a, you know, very high incidence of the disease in unvaccinated people. So pre-pandemic, the rate of increase in life expectancy was greatest in middle-income countries, and quite a lot of them have been very badly hit by the pandemic. So just in terms of, you know, lifespan, obviously the effects are going to be entirely negative. One place where there's a crossover with what I've been talking about was I showed Joan Manick and her work with rapamycin and the potentiation of the response to flu. She's also shown that rapamycin is actually protective in COVID. It's at a particular stage of disease development, it's quite remarkably protective. So there is a crossover there as well. So I think part of it will be, you know, just the drugs that we've understood and the way in which they might affect respiratory infections, and part of it is on life expectancy. I think those would be the main things. Of course, long COVID is, you know, a bad condition and is proving to be sadly prevalent, but I think probably that's a separate phenomenon from the aging process.
There's another really interesting question here, Linda, which is, would some longevity drugs be effective at certain ages but detrimental at other ages, given that our genetics are geared to lifespan of 40 and person-to-person variation?
I think that's really important, and it's something that we don't know a huge amount about at the moment. I mean, obviously, ideally, we would prefer to start any kind of drug thing as late as possible and still get the full benefit. So there's been a lot of interest in that kind of timing. It does look for most drugs as though actually the earlier you start, the better, unfortunately. So there may be a bit of a balancing act going on there. And certainly you wouldn't want to give a drug like rapamycin to very young adults, even at low doses. You know, it's likely to tamp down the anabolic effects, the growth, the repair and so on, to an extent that might not be advantageous. So I do think there's going to be a balance of effects there. One very important thing, though, one very positive thing, is it's turning out that some of these drugs, and that includes rapamycin, actually you can give them very intermittently. You can just give the system a quick buzz and remove the drug and still get a very beneficial effect. So I think intermittent dosing may well turn out to be important. You just give the system a kick every so often and it goes into a better way of running, a healthier way of running. So I think these timing experiments, we just need to do a lot more of them.
So kind of 60,000 mile service.
Exactly.
Give it for a quick tune up and a quick dose of rapamycin. So there's another interesting question. Does the preventative, the geroprotective medications that you're talking about have the same effect on all races? Because we've seen a big effect, for instance, on COVID. We know that some medicines are less effective in some people with different heritages.
Well, the ones that have being looked at seriously so far. So if I took metformin and rapamycin as the two exemplars, in terms of treatment of the conditions for which they're licensed at the moment, so type 2 diabetes for metformin, trying to prevent transplant rejection, restenosis, cancer chemotherapeutic, they work across the board. So I don't know of any evidence of reduced efficacy in relation to race for the clinical indications for which they're used. We wouldn't, I think, know that yet for these geroprotective, much lower dose kind of effects, but certainly Joan in her studies, Joan Manick, it included, you know, a typical American mix when she was working in the States, but also worked in different parts of the world when she was doing her clinical trials. And I think the responses were very similar in different parts of the world. So it may well turn out that there are subtle differences, but at the moment, I don't think there are indications of any big differences.
So Linda, rejuvenation, fountains of youth, in the 30s, we had Voronoff and his monkey glands. So all throughout history, there have been attempts for people to look at rejuvenation, and there have been some right old charlatans involved in anti-aging. So how do you stop this kind of research getting hijacked by folk with not a lot of science behind them, but a desire to get rich quick?
That's a very interesting question, and I have to choose my words carefully, obviously. I'm not sure that what you describe would not be happening irrespective of the kind of thing that people like me are doing. I think there's been quackery around since the dawn of people, and obviously aging is an area where it's going to crop up because people want to live forever, or some people want to live forever. So yes, it's there. There is a lunatic fringe, and there are some quack remedies that are being pushed. I'm not sure that actually mainline aging research is making that worse, if you see what I mean. Yes, sometimes ideas get hijacked a bit, but I think all of that would be happening anyway, actually.
Yes, I mean, it's already, I mean, the work on, young blood, although actually I have to say, Linda, I always thought that that an older mouse who was attached to a younger mouse, one of the reasons that he might have become a more active mouse was simply because he was being dragged round by his young mouse friend.
You know, I think that might be true. If you look at the films of conjoined mice, it's very obvious that two old mice just sit quietly, whereas an old mouse conjoined to a young mouse is being run around the cage. So
yes. What do you mean you don't want to go to a party? You're coming.
So I think that's why the change to actually transferring plasmas is less complicated to interpret than the original experiments. But the original experiments were very revealing, that there was something interesting to discover there.
So another comment here, fascinating lecture. You're getting a lot of fascinating lecture comments here, Linda. Is there any evidence for the most beneficial pattern and duration for intermittent fasting? I mean, we've seen the 5-2 diet, the 7-2 diet, there's all sorts.
I think in people, the experiments just haven't been done. So we just don't know. I mean, certainly for weight loss, intermittent fasting is extremely effective. Whether it's also the most health-giving way of dealing with diet, I think is an open question at the moment. Time-restricted feeding also seems to be, very effective. So if people only eat, over an eight-hour period during the waking period, again, that seems to be an extraordinarily effective way for losing weight. But I think we don't know what the long-term consequences are in people. We just don't have the information. And I could tell you what the situation is in mice. It's clear that both are very highly beneficial for long-term health. So intermittent fasting can achieve some of the same benefits as dietary restriction when it's done lifelong. Although as the animals get older, again, you have to be a bit careful and ease off. So like drugs, the effects of diet may be somewhat age-specific. And that's something that we don't know a huge amount about at the moment. There are dietary recommendations for older people, but if you actually look carefully at the evidence on which they're based, it's not experimental.
It's not experimental, and quite a lot of the dietary advice is based on very, very old work.
Exactly.
Yeah. Another question here, is combining longevity drugs and studies with epigenetics and how to maximise our DNA potential coming together a way to avoid even turning on genes like BRCA?
That's interesting. I think turning on and off genes, certainly with diet, is something that you, by taking diet down, you can go below the level at which you would activate some disadvantageous genes. That's clear. BRCA, being involved in DNA repair, I don't know if that's a dietary responsive gene or not. I think we just don't have the evidence on that.
Somebody's saying about often we're siloed in our approaches, epigenetics, longevity drugs, holistic approaches that focus. How do we focus on sunlight, grounding, breath, all those kind of things? How do we bring together all these different elements of aging? I'm thinking about the way that we think about how social life is a very important aspect of aging, exercise and diet, these drugs. How do we bring it all together in a holistic way?
Well, I think that's what's happened in some of these parts of the world where there seem to be such excellent aging stars. I mean, Okinawa in the old days. And as I said earlier, I think it's this combination of low stress, good diet, moderate but not ridiculous amounts of exercise and so on, and just bringing them all together. The social question of how you achieve that in real old people living in the real kinds of environments that we all live in now, with the various, stresses and challenges, including financial challenges that go on is, I think, a very, very complicated question. But I do think it's one in which public health people should be taking an interest.
Alf Adams, I think you've got a question. You need to unmute. There we are. Lovely.
Yes. I wondered, could you say a little more about the relationship between longevity and the method of dying? Are we going to expect, if we live a healthy life, a long healthy life, that certain mechanisms like cardiac arrest and so on will become a more common way of people losing their lives? And the other thing is that, are there any good books which you could recommend for people who are unable to, who badly need to get the information, but are unable to scan through all the interesting papers that you mentioned?
Both very interesting questions, especially the first. I can certainly send you some recommendations about books that you could give to people. But the means of dying, I think probably what we'd all want for ourselves is a long, healthy life and to die in our sleep, isn't it?
Yes.
And so it's very important, I think, particularly in these animal models, to understand what's happening there. And one of the things about dietary restriction, where I mentioned that still at the moment that's the most powerful intervention that we have, is that with the control, you know, ad libitum, fully fed animals, they usually died of something really obvious that you can diagnose post-mortem. So they had a big tumour or something was wrong with their lungs, or it's often clear what the animal died of, and it was a very specific disease condition. And often they have to be euthanized because they suffer from those conditions visibly in the run-up to death. And humane animal husbandry says that, you know, if the animal has reached a threshold where it's clearly suffering, then the Home Office rules say it must be euthanized, and I think quite rightly so. The interesting thing with the dietary restricted animals is they're often running around healthy one day and dead the next, and you can't really say what they died of. If you do a post-mortem, it's not clear. They just died. So I think that that's an interesting indication that perhaps we might be able to get there. Because if all that we're doing otherwise is simply, you know, lengthening the time before all the same things that are happening now happen, then I would say we haven't achieved much, because we haven't reduced the overall burden of suffering. We've just shifted it to later in life. What we want to do is to compress and ameliorate it. And at least for dietary restriction, which is the one that we know the best because we've known about it for much longer and it's much been much more thoroughly studied, I think there are some indications that that's exactly what's happening. So I would see some cause for optimism there. But I do think it's an absolutely crucial question. I think it's really important.
And that is a perfect point, Linda, on which to end this event, full of optimism for the future. We've had an absolutely fascinating discussion and a terrific, terrific lecture. So thank you so much for giving it to us, and for your patient answering of all the questions that we've taken. Can I also thank Max Liu, our President and Vice Chancellor, and as well as Alf Adams and Martin Sweeting, who give their names to this very prestigious lecture series. And actually, I think that you've done extremely well, both of you, to have your names attached to this lecture series, because it's obviously going to be terrific. And thank you, all of you who contributed to the Q&A. I'm sorry if we didn't get to all your questions, but I hope, nevertheless, that you've taken a great deal away from you about this whole subject of ageing. And we hope that we're going to see some of you in person in future for Adam Sweeting lectures. And do check back on the website, where you'll see more information about what's coming up next. And we're going to leave you with some details on the following screen. But to all of you, good night. And thank you again, Dame Linda Partridge. What a wonderful lecture. Thank you.